Right. Good morning, everybody. Happy Sabbath. Yes. Thanks. I love seeing such a full church. We've got our Coralwood choir visiting us. We've got a lot of new faces, a lot of familiar faces. Do we have anybody visiting for the very first time at Edmonton Central? Oh, lots of hands up here. All right, so the deacons are going to come. So if you can leave up your hand, we're so thankful that you are here. We've got a small gift for you. So if you can leave your hand up high so they can see you, that'd be wonderful. So we're going to start with some announcements this morning. So for especially for those of you guys visiting, we need to have a parking placard. So on your visor, you need to make sure that you have got the parking placard that indicates that you're here and that you can park so that you don't get ticketed. You're able to park in any of the lot that is beside us, up to the high center and in behind the church here. But that placard does have to be displayed, and it's valid from 9 a.m. to 9 p.m. If you do not have one, please see a greeter and they can get you one to put into your vehicle. We definitely don't want you to get ticketed while you are here. This afternoon at 4 o'clock, we are going to have a Bible class or Bible study with Pastor David. The link is in your newsletter or it is in your bulletin. This afternoon's topic is the delay of the second coming. So we welcome you guys to join us for that. It's a wonderful time to study together. And then our talent night has been moved from April 20th to the 13th. Come and show your talents. We've got a lot of talent in this church. We've seen it up here in multiple ways. So please sign up by the 11th. You can talk to Lorraine, you can talk to Jean, or you can talk to Orville, or there's sign-up sheets in the lobby or in the bulletin boards as well. But please come and share your talents with the church, and also come and watch. And then you can come on April 20th at 5:30 to discover the Jewish background to the Lord's Supper. We're going to do the Paschal Supper with Pastor David. The link has been corrected in the newsletter, but please sign up if you're interested in coming and learning about this because space is limited. So April 12th is the deadline for that. So there's a lot of deadlines this week. Then the Share Him mission trip to Panama. The age is now open to age 16 to 37. Pastor Jacques can give you guys more information. But again, you can reserve your spot on that wonderful mission trip. There's a QR code in the lobby. And then the Pathfinders, they need your support. They are still raising funds for the International Camporee in Wyoming in August. So right now they are doing a bottle drive. So if you can bring your bottles to church, you can put it down in the fellowship hall next to the Pathfinder closet or in the Pathfinder closet. And then lastly, on April 27th, we have the marriage enrichment evening. And so there is going to be a light supper. We invite all married couples, please sign up and come. Their posters are also in the bulletin boards. There's sign-up sheets there, or you can come and see like myself or Hayden or Joy to sign up. Pastor Rob and Takshila will be here to speak that evening. And like I said, there will be a light supper. So we would love to see couples here, and there will be child care available. Please make sure you register. I think it's April 12th for that one as well. And lastly, in preparation for service, we just ask that you please silence your cell phones so that we're not interrupted while we worship together. Have a wonderful morning.
Happy Sabbath, everybody. Good. It's great to hear you. This morning for our call to worship, I'd like to turn to Psalms 29, verse 1. Where it says, "Give unto the Lord, O you mighty ones, give unto the Lord glory and strength. Give unto the Lord the glory due to his name. Worship the Lord in the beauty of holiness." Let us pray. Dear Heavenly Father, I pray that you be with us this Sabbath morning in our service as we sing songs of praise to you, as we return a portion of what you have given to us as an offering, and as we listen to your word, may everything be done to your honor and glory. Pray in Jesus' name, amen. Amen. At this time, it's time for our offering. I'd invite the deacons and deaconesses to please come forward. This Sabbath offering is for the church family budget. This is the only offering that stays in the church, that is used for the upkeep of the church, that's used to run the services that we run as a church. So I'd ask that you remember the church offering as well as your other tithes and offerings this morning. Let us pray. Dear Heavenly Father, thank you for your goodness to us. We live in a land of prosperity. And I pray this morning as we return a portion of what you have given us back to you, that you would bless it, that it might be used effectively to further your work. Pray in Jesus' name. Amen. At this time, there'll be a short offering video.
Adelaide's world was turned upside down when her husband died in 2011 in New Zealand. 3 years later, she suffered another blow when she lost her father. Adelaide began to wonder where God was and also what had happened to her husband and father after their death. One day, while flipping TV channels, Adelaide came across the Seventh-day Adventist channel for the first time. Deciding to watch the program for just a few minutes, she was instantly hooked. She was amazed to realize that her questions were being answered. The truths she found brought her peace about issues such as the state of the dead. She and her entire family went to church and are now actively awaiting Christ's return. Adelaide didn't know at that time that you may have participated in sharing God's message with her. In 2016, a portion of the mission offerings collected from all Adventist churches worldwide was sent to New Zealand. So, if in 2016 or immediately before, you allowed your offering to be distributed according to what the combined offering plan suggests, your offering made part of Adelaide's conversion. At that time, the church in New Zealand had the audacious dream of broadcasting the Adventist Channel, Hope Channel, nationwide for free. Thanks to the offerings, this dream has come true. Today, over 170,000 people watch the channel monthly, and hundreds, like Adelaide, attend Seventh-day Adventist churches. This system of collecting mission offerings from all over the world and then applying them in the most challenging or strategic places, projects, and ministries is working wonders. The General Conference regularly receives a portion of the world mission offerings from the divisions and reallocates these funds to mission projects, institutions, and ministries worldwide. Those who receive those funds could never dream of doing the work with their local resources. One of the strategic missionary agencies that regularly receives funds from your mission offerings is the Hope Channel. But if, in addition to your promise or regular offerings, you are impressed to send a special offering to the Hope Channel, you may access hopechannelinternational.org/giving. Together, we do more and go faster and farther. As we return your tithes and promise offerings, may we put our desires last and God first.
Happy Sabbath. It's good to see all of you here today and to have a church so full. We hope and pray that you had a blessed week this week. If your week was anything like mine, it had some really high highs and some a little lows. And regardless, we're just happy to be here to praise and worship God. This morning, we're going to do just two songs with you. They're contemporary songs. We've done them a few times with you here before. So we pray that these songs may be a blessing to you as we worship today. Our songs today will be reflecting on God's goodness and His power and His love for us. Our first song is going to be The Goodness of God.
Until I raise my head, I will sing of the goodness of God. And all my life you have been faithful. And all my life you have been so, so good. With every breath that I am able, I will sing of the goodness of God. I love your voice. You have led me through the fire. In the darkest nights, you are close like no other. I've known you as a father.
Congregation to stand with us now as we sing our opening song, What a Beautiful Name.
Thank you.
At this time, I'd invite you to kneel with me in prayer, wherever possible. Our dear Heavenly Father, we come before you this Sabbath morning to worship you because you are worthy. For you are the one who created us and give us every breath that we breathe. You are the one that watches over us and provides for us. You are the one who sent your only Son to pay the penalty for our sins. And you are the one who gives us hope, who lives in our hearts to free us from the power of sin. We thank you for your great goodness this morning. And as we come before you, we know that we are not worthy. We know that we are fallen, that our hearts stray from you. But we know that you love us, dear Heavenly Father. And we know that you give us hope for something better. And this is why we worship you this morning. Be with each one here. Be with each one watching online. You know each one of us. You know the hairs on our heads. You know our ups and downs, our joys and sorrows. And I pray that you'll be with us and that you'll keep our eyes turned upon you, that you will live in our lives that others might know that we are your disciples because of our love. Thank you this morning that Coralwood can be with us. Thank you for the Christian school that we have here in this city that we can send our children to. Pray that you'll be with the staff and the students who are there, that your will might be done, and be with them this morning as they put on the program. And we pray that you'll be with Erica as she brings your word to us this morning, that you the words she speaks might be your words, and be with each one of us as we listen, that our hearts might be open to receive the word and the blessing you have for us. Pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Good morning, boys and girls.
Good morning, Mr. Percy.
Today, I am going to tell you a story that I understand is true. Now, Coralwood children, is that a non-fiction or a fiction story?
Non-fiction.
That's right. It's a story about a pastor from Romania. Now, we even have some students who have grandparents that are from Romania, and I know them to be wonderful, kind people. And what about you? Do you all think your pastor is a wonderful, kind person?
Yes!
So, this pastor had a little kitten, and one day he went out into his backyard to find his little kitten had done what kitties sometimes love to do. He had climbed up into a tree. And you know what? Sometimes little kittens get themselves into a very troublesome situation that they have difficulty getting out of. And so the little kitten was crying up in the tree, and the pastor was so worried. He said, "What will I do?" So he called, "Here, kitty, 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 kitty." But the kitty was too frightened to come down. So he went into the house and got a saucer of milk, heated it up, made it nice and warm, brought it out and said, "Here, kitty, 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 kitty." But his little kitten was far too scared to come out of the tree. Well, the pastor looked at the tree, and the tree was too young and too skinny. He couldn't climb up the tree because it would break and the kitten would fall. So he thought, "What can I do?" And then he had an idea. He thought, "I think if I tie a rope onto the tree and hook up my car to the rope, I can pull the tree down slowly, just enough so I can reach the kitten." So, you see, he thought if he tied the rope, he could bend the tree slowly down and be able to get the kitten out. So he started driving very slowly with his car, and he kept looking and even getting out and checking the tree, and it was bending nicely, coming down, and just when he thought the tree was almost low enough that he could reach the kitten, the rope broke. Boing went the tree. There went the kitten, flying through the air. Oh no! The pastor was devastated. He went running about the neighborhood trying to find his flying kitten. He couldn't find that kitten anywhere. He looked and looked for several hours. And then at last, he just went home and did what pastors do. He prayed to God and committed that little kitten into his care. And he worried and missed his little kitten, but a few days later, he went shopping. And sure enough, it was a small community, and he met up with one of his church members, a lady who was getting her groceries. And as he walked by, he said hello, and he did what most pastors wouldn't dare do. He looked into her cart, and what do you think he saw? No, he didn't see the kitten, but he saw cat food. And he said, "Oh," he couldn't help but ask, Why are you buying cat food when I know, and everyone else knows, you don't like cats? And she said, well, Pastor, you're not going to believe this. She says, you know, my little girl has been asking and asking me and begging for a kitten for a couple years. And just a few days ago, she was asking me again, and she wouldn't leave me alone. So I told her, you know what? You go ask God for a kitten, and if he gives you one, you can have one. And so she went out into the backyard, and she knelt down, and she was praying. And Pastor, you're not going to believe this. I wouldn't either, but I saw it with my very own eyes. There from the sky, with all legs out, flew the kitten right down in front of her. She said, well, what am I going to do? God gave her a kitten, so now we have a kitten. And the pastor just smiled and thanked God for his creative way to answer the little girl's prayer. So children, we must remember that God is the master. God is the master creator, and he has all sorts of ways to answer our prayers. As long as we ask in faith, he will give us what we need. Thank you, and you may return to your seats.
Good morning, church family, and a special welcome to those that are visiting with us online today. Today's scripture reading is taken from Jeremiah 1, verse 5. I'll be reading from the New King James Version. Before I formed you in the womb, I knew you. Before you were born, I sanctified you. May God add the blessing to the reading of his word.
My voice is clear. Good morning and happy Sabbath. Thank you for allowing Coralwood to come into your church today. Just as I was listening to them sing, it's actually a weekly thing for them to go to chapel, and every chance a staff member gets to just sit and listen to the little kids sing, we appreciate that moment because we can hear a piece of heaven. My name is Erica Dees. If you've been around for a while, I've been around for a while. As you'll find out today, I have a story behind every single thing in my life. I am the homeroom teacher for grade 5 and 6 this year. I've added elementary vice principal to my title this year, and a few others. There are many hats I wear, but today is not about me, it's not about my accomplishment, it's about our God that we serve. I'm here to share a little piece of my testimony as a person, as a teacher, but however, what I hope you see today is not the person before you, but a God who is able to take a single strand and weave it into a beautiful tapestry. It is my hope today that it's not just my testimony, but it's His. So before I start, let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, please anoint my lips. I'm here to speak, but I'm here to speak on your behalf. Please give me your words to speak that you may be seen throughout my story. In your name I pray, amen. I forgot my clicker, if you don't mind, sorry. Thank you. All right. So, I was born in a small town called Woodstock, New Brunswick. As of the 2021 census, the population was 5,553. Like I said, it was small. Oh, that did not work out properly. That's okay. My village of residence was even smaller. It was a village named Canterbury, also located in New Brunswick, where the 2016 census gave a number of 336. It's the kind of place where people use the phrase, if you blink while you're driving through it, you'll miss it. New Brunswick is a very rural place. And I apologize for, oh, now it's not working. Oh, there we go. The pictures are a little off, but that's okay. Our cities are not big. Our malls are not that great. We're known for farmers markets more than we are for shopping. What we lack in conveniences, we make up for in nature. New Brunswick is best described as a lot of trees, a decent amount of water, and a sprinkle of people. In fact, using the 2019 census, the entire province of New Brunswick's population is a fifth of just the city of Edmonton. My hometown, my village, and my beginning, what I knew was very small. I grew up not knowing who God really was. By the time I was 5, my parents divorced. As you can imagine, that had a large impact on my life. After my mom remarried, we began moving a lot due to my stepdad's work. By the time I finished high school, I had already moved 18 times, and I had attended about 9 different schools. My life was inconsistent in many ways, and I hated always making friends and having to leave and start all over again. As far as church was concerned, I spent a lot of time bouncing around, which led me to learn some things about God, but never really helped me gain a solid ground of who He was. As per my parents' agreement, one weekend, my sister and I would be with our father at the Catholic church on one side of the road, and on the other weekends, we'd be with my mom and my stepdad at the United church on the other side of the road. Once we started moving a lot, we sometimes attended church, sometimes we didn't. Sometimes it would be United, sometimes we'd try something different. Inconsistency was my way of life and had every potential to derail me in so many directions. Though I didn't know it then, I can see it so plainly now that even with small beginnings and a constantly disrupted life, God was using those experiences to mold me and shape me to become the person I am today. There came a time in my life when my family had a very large decision to make. My stepfather is both an electrician and a truck driver. When there was electrical work, he would do that. But in times when work was slow, he would also go into full-time truck driving. When I was in grade 6, work had become very slow. In conversations that I don't remember too well, the decision was made to try moving west. My stepdad began working for the oil fields and came out to almost a year before the rest of us. If you would like to know the truth, I was not a bundle of rainbows and butterflies. On the contrary, I was angry because this move didn't just mean leaving my friends and my schools, but it also meant leaving my entire family and everything I knew behind. We had to leave the place of the small and poor to the place of the big and rich. As soon as school was over, my grade 7 year, my mom left with my only brother at that time and headed straight for Alberta. My sister and I stayed for the summer to visit with our grandparents and to also spend time with our dad. At the end of summer, my mom's parents agreed to drive us across Canada to our new home in Cold Lake. It took us 4 days to reach Cold Lake, and once we reached there, there was a bit of excitement about touring a new place and learning about a new community. We didn't stay in Cold Lake long before we drove down to see the big city of Edmonton, which, let me tell you, at that time was a culture shock for me. Sure, we had driven through some cities or even by some cities as we drove to Alberta, but that was my first experience spending any amount of time in a large city. I was seeing things to me that were only things from TV. It was something I couldn't relate to. It was strange. I was that one strand, just one girl from a small place in a small world that had no idea how to fit into this big world yet. After our visit to West Edmonton Mall, my family split. My grandparents head back to New Brunswick, and we headed back to Cold Lake. I can remember sitting in my new house and hearing about the school I would go to, but never really feeling like any of it was real. I was so far away from home, and I felt like a stranger. My parents did their best to make us feel at home and ease the transition, but it simply just stayed strange. Only 2 nights after returning to Cold Lake, there was a phone call that came in, and I just happened to be the one to answer it. My grandmother was on the other end, but she did not sound like herself. I knew something was wrong. She asked to speak to my mom, and my mom took the phone upstairs to her room. Wanting to listen, I sat on the stairs. The words, "Oh, Mom," cried out in agony, and my stepdad ran past me on the stairs to find out what was wrong. Though I had to wait for what seemed like an eternity, we were sat down and told the news. My grandparents had been traveling back through Thunder Bay, Ontario. A vehicle had pulled out to pass a semi-truck and did not see their vehicle in the oncoming lane. They had hit my grandparents head-on. My grandfather had died on impact, and my grandmother was currently in the hospital. My mom was an only child, so very quickly we were packed, thrown in the car, and headed straight back to Edmonton to go to the airport. It is difficult for me to describe my grandfather to you unless you've been in a similar situation. If you've ever had that one person who has stuck with you no matter what, who has provided for you any time you ever needed it, or most importantly for me, has followed you no matter where you have gone, that was my grandfather. He was the rock of my family. He was always there. In fact, it was so hard to accept his death that when we had moved back to New Brunswick, my mother and I would find ourselves sitting in the living room of his house with a feeling that he was just at work at the office and we were still just waiting for him to come home. What a surreal feeling. So here we were, with a failed attempt to move across the country, with a tragic loss that we all felt, and back to square one in my original small village. This is where God really started to work. After my stepdad had returned to New Brunswick from closing up everything in Alberta, he had managed to find some work. He would be traveling throughout New Brunswick during the week, and he would be home on the weekends. Through the pain of losing my grandfather never left, I was back in the village where the majority of my family lived. I had cousins at school and friends from when I had attended that school years ago. What I had lost in my grandfather, I had gained in the rest of my family community being around me again. There were some crazy and difficult things that happened during that next year, but what I didn't know was that I was about to meet God for real this time. Unlike usual, my stepdad came home one Friday telling us that we were going to church tomorrow. Now, up to this point, I had never heard anyone who goes to church on a Saturday. That was more foreign to me than traveling across the country. My dad went on to explain that there was just some man at work that was holding Bible studies at lunch, and he went in to question him. To help you understand, my stepdad is very much a prove-it-to-me kind of man. He has questions, and he wants you to prove the answers. So he went in, and I wish I could tell you what questions he asked, but the truth is I don't really know. All I know is that he kept going back. The man that was hosting these Bible studies had surpassed his expectations and was able to provide any answer to every question he had, proving his answers both historically and biblically, something nobody else had been able to do. It had convicted him so much that when the man offered for him to come and see his church, my dad accepted. But then there was us. By this point, I was in grade 8. In New Brunswick, we do things a little bit different. Grades 6 to 8 is considered middle school, and then grade 9 to 12 is considered high school. So for me, I was just 1 year short of starting my high school career, and being in such a small village, half an hour from the nearest police station, grocery store, or anything of excitement, school dances and community dances on a Friday night were our biggest source of fun. Who in the world gets up on a Saturday morning to drive an hour through the woods to go to church? Well, that was about to be us. When I say through the woods, I do mean dirt roads and through the woods. New Brunswick is a lot of trees, a decent amount of water, and just a sprinkle of people. Our biggest industry is the logging industry, and so we have many dirt and old logging roads that go throughout the province. So while my dad drove the family the hour's drive through the woods, we were again in limbo with our thoughts of what to expect. What we came upon was a small building that kind of looked like a church, but bore a name I didn't know, Zealand Seventh-day Adventist Church. I don't remember much about the church service itself. I remember meeting the man who had now become my stepdad's friend. I remember meeting his family and being introduced to several people in the church. And I remember also considering that perhaps this would just be another church visit and I shouldn't get settled too fast. My dad's friend had invited us over for lunch, and this is where my second shock came. They had prepared a very simple, very traditional New Brunswick meal of homemade baked beans and homemade bread. It wasn't the meal that shocked me, it was the conversation. These people were vegetarians. They actually didn't eat meat. Now today, I'm speaking to a house of Adventists. The word vegetarian is pretty common. But I need you to understand that I grew up in the woods, and where hunting was a way of life. The men gather during the key seasons, deer, moose, and partridge, and they gather for fishing season as well to stock up the freezer for the winter. To me, vegetarian was nothing more than you would see on a celebrity magazine, something they claim is real, but isn't really. I had never met a vegetarian, nor even heard of someone being vegetarian anywhere around me. Yet here were these strange people who didn't eat meat. I would love to tell you that it was some spectacular message in church that grabbed my heart that day, but in all reality, what struck me the most was the vegetarian diet. Never underestimate the impact that living for God in all ways can have on those around you. I still thank God today that we have a health message. From this point, we were getting more acceptable of going to church. From my perspective, we were welcomed and came to feel like we belonged. There weren't too many people at that church, perhaps less than 50, but there was a girl my age that I particularly connected with, and that helped as well. When that first summer came, they invited us to something called camp meeting. This, again, was another great decision on behalf of my parents. Though I didn't get baptized the first summer, my parents and my grandmother did. For me, I was just learning that there were many other people my age that belonged to this Adventist belief. Though I didn't realize it at the time, after all that I had lost in my life, God was refilling me with so much more. Now, I wish I could tell you everything was good, everything got better, life was perfect, but I can't because it would dismiss what God really did for me. Sure, I liked my new friends, and Pugwash, Nova Scotia, was one of the most amazing experiences of my life, but after Pugwash, I still went home, and I still had my other friends. I still had my old life to go back to, and as I learned, breaking from that was hard. It was not by choice that I could no longer go to school and community dances. I would be angry at home because I could hear the music down the road and knew where all my friends are, and I was the only one who was not allowed to go. Learning about a Sabbath, what that meant and how to keep it was a massive transition for me. It wasn't only me at school who had never heard of an Adventist before, but my entire community had never heard of an Adventist before. I was questioned at school as to why things were different, what I even was now, and sometimes those conversations were awkward because I barely understood. We go to church and we don't do other things on Saturday was sometimes the best explanation I could give, which reminds me of the next verse. I was that babe in this verse, the baby. I was just beginning to figure out what a new life looked like and why it had to be so different from my old one. Everything I had known, even in all its inconsistency, was being challenged. Giving up things is hard, especially when you don't yet fully understand why something is wrong. I had lots to still learn. Despite the challenges that came with the transition my family made, by the second summer, I also had decided to give my life to Jesus at Pugwash Camp Meeting. At this time in my life, I was learning at such a rapid rate. My life was beginning to change so quickly. And yet somewhere in all of that, there was this pull, this tug on my heart saying, come to know me. And all I managed to do was say yes. In the background of that second summer in Pugwash, behind my baptism studies and my decision to live for God, my family had taken with us a burden to lay at Christ's feet. My stepdad had been out of work again for a few months, and we had decided that while at Pugwash, we would not stress about it. We would instead give the situation over to God, and at the end of the week, my stepdad would call his boss. If work was still not available for over a month, we would try moving west again, but this time all at once as a family. The bitter and angry girl who drove across the country with her grandparents just 2 years before had already begun God's transformation. My attitude was completely different, and though it saddened me to think of leaving my family again, this time I was on board because somehow I seemed to understand. The end of Pugwash came, the call was made, there was no work. So we had one week, to say goodbye to everyone. We were allowed one garbage bag each to fill with our clothes, our shoes, or whatever we could fit in. Those bags filled the trunk of an old Chevrolet Lumina, and all of our pots and pans went under our feet. We were told of this Adventist place we must go to in the town of Lacombe, Alberta. We packed up the six of us by this point, and we headed out. When we managed to get to Lacombe, the housing situation was a bit of a disaster. We were told a place would be available for us that wasn't, and we ended up staying in five different places in the first 2 months. It was actually my vice principal at Parkview Adventist Academy who had seen my mom crying, needing to leave our fourth place. That made arrangements for us to have a remaining student apartment on campus for the rest of the year. My stepdad traveled to NISCU and back for work every day so that his children could attend Adventist education. Though my parents found it very difficult and the situation did not last that way forever, they did everything they could to make it work. The apartment we received was small. There were six of us and only two bedrooms. At first, everything we did was on the floor. We slept on the floor, ate on the floor, did everything on the floor because we didn't have money to buy furniture. Eventually, my dad had worked enough that he could start buying a few pieces of furniture. The living room became a room with two single beds, a couch and a TV, serving as both living room and my sister's and my bedroom. To anybody who would have looked from the outside in, we were the family of have-nots. Yet if you ask me about that year, I will tell you I had an amazing year. I was surrounded by people who believed like me, in fact, knew more than me. My new friends had grown up in church, and though they weren't perfect and, of course, were prone to some of the same worldly temptations as my friends back home, I had teachers and I had leaders who spoke, led, and guided us back to the Word and God's truth. The lines between good and evil were becoming more clear to me, and as I began to see how this new world lives and breathes in the same world that I live in, I was being filled with the grounding I would need for years to come. By the end of my grade 10 year, we were told we needed to move again. Our housing situation was only temporary, and driving to NISCU and back, especially on Alberta winter highways, was a concern. My brother was starting to get in trouble at school, and my mother decided it was best for the family to just be together more often. We did not have a house to move into right away, so my parents purchased a camping trailer, and we lived in that. We moved to a campground in Leduc, and we lived there for 4 months. Sure, I was angry, and probably made my parents' lives miserable, because I had finally found what I thought was my place and my people, and was being uprooted again. But living in the camping trailer that summer wasn't so bad. Eventually, we did purchase a home, and because we had missed the first month of school, my mom decided we would all do homeschool. Doing grade 11 on homeschool was an experience, and my mom quickly learned that my brother and sister did not respond well to being home with her as her teacher every day. So she found Coralwood here in Edmonton, where she decided to enroll my brother and sister there. At that time, Coralwood was only K-9 school, so she trusted me to stay home and finish my grade 11 education. Though I was very academic and I loved school, I also found out I could work in my extra time and fell in love with working a little too much. Not only would I work full-time, but I would also jump on overtime opportunities, not because of money, but because I found something fulfilling in work. During this time, my mother had found out that my brother was having seizures. The reason he had been getting in trouble at school was not actually because he was ignoring the teacher, but because his brain was having the type of seizure that doesn't cause you to shake, but instead makes it look like you're just staring into the distance and unaware of anything around you. She became heavily involved with the Edmonton Epilepsy Association as she began to navigate some very difficult times. What added to the stress was that my stepdad had been promoted in his company and was being transferred to shift work up in Fort McMurray, where he would now be gone for weeks at a time. It left a lot on her shoulders. So by the end of grade 11, I only completed half of my schoolwork because I spent so much time working. My mother told me I had to go back to school and looking for a school that was closer to our home so that she could be within minutes of reaching my brother if he had another seizure at school, enrolled the three of us that were school-aged at Millwoods Christian School. Though it wasn't an Adventist school, I did find it respectable enough. They did put effort into trying to build a spiritual atmosphere, though I found Bible classes very broad and unfocused. I only had 1 year there and had to complete all of my grade 12 education as well as half a year of grade 11 that I had missed. And I didn't care to spend the time to make friends, though I did have a few. It was time for me to get ready for university, and I had a lot of thinking to do. I wasn't someone who knew exactly what career path I would take. I knew I liked psychology, and the idea of education was in my head, too. I had applied to a few universities in Edmonton and received my acceptance letters when my parents sat us down for yet another conversation. My mom was finding it too difficult with my brother's epilepsy and having no family around. With Dad being gone a couple weeks at a time, she really needed to be around family for support. Dad had already gotten permission to fly to New Brunswick on his weeks off, and they had made the decision to list the house and move back. It is a theme in my life to think I know the plans I'm going to take and then find out that my plans are no longer going to work. I have resolved to say that all I can tell you is where I am today, where I hope to be tomorrow, and I can assure you beyond all else that above my plan, any plan I could ever make, is a God who is always going to correct a path for me to travel because his vision far surpasses my own. I'll be very honest, I did not like Edmonton at that time. It was still too big for me. I had just finished driver's training, and what a different world driving in Edmonton compared to those old country roads back home. Nothing about this city enticed me to stay here by myself, and so after throwing out all of my acceptance letters, I very quickly filled out one last application with a prayer that CUC would still take me. In August 2007, I became a student at CUC. It wasn't my original plan. I wasn't even sure of what I wanted to do yet. God had so many plans for me. In all of those moments of uncertainty, God created a path for me. They accepted me. They accepted my application. They created a home for me. They taught me in every class about a God who always loved me. Throughout all of my moves and all of my schools, I always found that I loved the smaller ones the best, the ones that were often K-12 in one building. The ones that didn't have four grade three classes or five grade six classes, it was the ones where people actually knew me and I actually knew them. CUC is a little bigger than small schools that I had attended, but for university it was small. And I can tell you that I loved every minute of being at that place. The education that I received is something I would not trade for the world. Sorry, I got a dry spot in my throat. Yes, I can tell you that there is no university, don't let them fool you, that can ever completely prepare you for being a teacher. It just simply can't be done. But what CUC gave me was more than I would have received anywhere else. It gave me light, it gave me assistance and assurance. It clothed me with hope that I can go in the world and I can actually make a difference for a God I had come to love. God disrupted my life to lead me to a place where he knew I would grow the most. He took me to exactly where I needed to be. The day after I graduated, I had my first interview. I drove out to the small area of Wetaskiwin to apply for a maternity leave teaching position. The school was a three-room school, grades K to nine, which also meant teaching multiple grades at the same time. I was actually excited about this new opportunity. I had such great hopes to finally start teaching my own class. I learned that the majority of my eight students would be coming in from a bus off of the First Nations Reserve. I had eight students, ranging from grades four to six. It was an amazing first year. However, I was thrown into a lot of things that I didn't know. Because the teacher I replaced had taught all the way up to the day of her delivery, I was needed before the end of the school year. Grade fives and sixes go to something called outdoor school. And though I had only been there 1 week, I was told to pack up my car as if I was going camping and drive four students down to Foothills. I can tell you now, post-experience, that involves a little more than just that. However, we packed my car with no extra room, and I took myself and those four students to Foothills, and we had a blast. I was exhausted by the end, but it was a lot of fun. I would like to call that step one of my initiation into teaching. Things pop up in the teaching world all the time, and we have the decision to say yes to flexibility or not. Though I loved my teaching position at this school, I knew it would eventually be over. The spring came and time was running out. However, I already had a plan to go fill a maternity leave in Medicine Hat. But remember how I said I learned not to plan too far in advance? Because that was my plan, to go fill in for a maternity at another Adventist school in Medicine Hat. Sounds godly, sounds right, a big change, but I was used to that. However, as godly as it sounded, it just wasn't God's plan. My superintendent showed up to our school for a visit and requested that I finish my position there early because the teacher in Medicine Hat had been put on stress leave early due to some complications with her pregnancy. However, my head teacher told them no, so they gave away my job. When I heard that, I remember laying on my classroom floor at the end of the day and asking God why. What was wrong with that plan? Because now I have nothing, or so I thought. A couple weeks later, I received a phone call from my superintendent, and I have to call this moment my Jonah moment, and I hope you understand why. If you can recall, I didn't like Edmonton. Living in Edmonton was my professed statement of I will never live there again. But lo and behold, from the other end of the line into my listening ear, my superintendent told me that I had an interview at Coralwood Adventist Academy in Edmonton on Thursday. All I could say was, but I didn't apply for the job. To which she replied to me, I know, we did for you. Now, I'm glad we used landlines for that call because if it had been in person or on video, I cannot account for the look on my face. I had 2 days to figure out what I was going to do with my kids for the afternoon, and I had an interview in a city that I didn't want to be. My conversations with God quickly changed from, what is your plan, to, what are you doing? Though I can say that I said yes to God at the time, I cannot claim I did so with a cheerful heart. I dragged my feet. I saw other adults in the office that day and thought, for sure, we must all be here for the same position. And so I was more than happy to let one of them get it instead of me. I did my interview with the superintendents and the principal, and I left feeling that day that I had respected everyone, but made sure that I didn't show too much enthusiasm. I left the building that day thinking, well, that's that. God's, they're going to choose somebody else. But God wasn't done with me yet. I got a phone call the next day congratulating me that I had gotten the grade 6 position. I attempted to sound excited on the phone, but I can assure you that God and I had a very sincere talk after that. Why, of all places, was he taking me back to the one city I said I would never live again? What in the world was he doing? So I'll say that I reluctantly said yes to God, moved, was thrown into a very different school situation than what I was used to, from a very small school in the country to a bigger school in the city. It took a couple years for me to find my footing at Coralwood. Fitting into the whole scheme of a different school was a bit tougher, but God's work was ever going through me and before me. By the third year, Coralwood has become my second home. I love my job. Not every year has been my favorite. Sometimes eternal shifts happen that aren't always what we want, but I can safely tell you that God has put some of my favorite moments in every year. Every year, he has blessed me with amazing students, some that need more patience and love than others. At the end of every year, I would sit in the stillness and quiet of my classroom and deal with a large amount of sadness when I realized they weren't coming back. Some were changing schools, or some simply just wouldn't be mine in my classroom anymore. Some people miss this about teachers, that to every teacher, behind all those emails and phone calls, is a teacher who's invested themselves or herself into that child and simply wants to do whatever we can to help them succeed. Yes, our school children kind of become our own, and it can be incredibly difficult to say goodbye when you've built a year of growing pains, successes, and memories together. I have not always felt like a good teacher, and if you ask me today, I will tell you there are probably better teachers out there. What I present to you today is not an example of a great and perfect teacher because I've checked all the boxes and I've gained all of the qualifications that have fitted me for worldly excellence and success. What I can present to you today is somebody, the unequipped person, that God chose who has simply learned to say yes so that he can teach me his excellence. Students have taught me many lessons, some harder to learn than others. But in all of my experiences, no matter how difficult, I've seen God work some amazing wonders in my classroom and in our school. I've seen kids change from being anxiety-filled and scared to walking boldly on a stage. I've seen our high school kids become these amazing people who fight for our school, their right to stay at our school, and tackle many leadership opportunities. We have students who bus over an hour each morning just to be within our walls. When we receive comments from bus drivers who we have to hire for our field trips, or field trip organizers who point out and say, your kids are different, they're so respectful, we celebrate that God is still working at our school. As a staff, we cry together, laugh together, work out our problems together, and when one of us suffers, we each carry each other's burdens. The staff meets every morning for worship, and we lay everything down at Jesus' feet so that he may go with us every day. Now, if you look at rating scales and program offerings and vast many other things that other schools offer, then no, we don't compare. We're simply too small. But if there is anything I have learned throughout my life and my teaching career, it is in those small places, those humble beginnings, that God sees, finds, and chooses people from whom he can conquer many great things. So long as they are willing to say yes. I can tell you that in our small, humble place, our school, academics are not our number one priority. They're number two behind God. God doesn't need our education, our certifications, our degrees, or our lineage. God's chosen people in the Bible were not the people that society would have chosen. God simply seeks those who are willing, those who want to chase him with all their hearts, and he does the equipping. The mission of our school is to reach the heart and mind of every student with the message of hope and wholeness, so that we can help those kids who walk through our door know a little more of who their father is, the plans he has for their life, and what God has prepared for them in just a short time. We may be small, but our focus is not lost. Though we may be imperfect and falter at times, I can assure you that the changes I've seen have not been due to my abilities or those of anyone else, but instead of the Holy Spirit who is alive and working within our walls. For someone who dragged my feet to be here in the first place, I am now on my 12th year. What keeps us going is not the pay, it's not the breaks or lack of work, it's the students and the God we serve. It's the stories of students who write you years later to tell you how you impacted their life. It's the stories of watching students change before your very eyes. It's the stories of seeing someone who never knew God suddenly realize there is someone who loves them immensely. It's the stories of students who gather teachers and their chaplain to be baptized in the summer. It's the growth of God before our very eyes that keeps us motivated in this position that God has called us to. And I firmly believe that so long as we keep our priorities straight, God will continue to let our school stand until the end has come. We have a work to do, and we fight against that world to do it every single day. I was asked to share my testimony and a leading into teaching, but my testimony is not just mine. My testimony is of a God who worked behind the scenes my entire life, every day since I was born, to prepare me for a work that he had planned. I had no idea where I was going or what I was going to do. I didn't always understand his plans or his promises for my future because I wasn't even a strong Christian. I had a lot of growing to do, in fact, much later than a lot of those around me. But here's what I've learned. God does not take your plans and say, oh, good enough. He takes our plans and says, I've got something better. He doesn't choose us the way a warrior might be chosen, the strongest, the bravest, the wisest, and best. He simply looks for those who are willing at heart. I've been told that saying yes to baptism is the best yes you can make, but I'm here to say that's not the only yes you should say. God simply asked us to say yes. Yes to his plans, yes to his interruptions, and yes to him. When we can do that, he will do the rest. Let go of whatever's holding you back, fear, worry, stress, the need to feel in control of your own life and destiny, and simply surrender it all to him. Tell God that yes, you're scared. Be honest with him. No, God, I don't like moving forward when I don't know what will happen next. Yes, God, failure and inadequacy are a real concern to me. But after you've shared your heart in honesty with him, simply sit at his feet and say, even so, let your will be done. Even so, God, despite all my fears, I'm willing to say yes and watch where Jesus leads. All God needs is your yes.
As we close our service, we'll invite everybody to stand, and we're going to sing the song, Come Thou Fount of Every Blessing. We're just going to sing the first and the last verses.
Let us bow our heads and pray. Dear Heavenly Father, I'm sure each of us has a story. It's our testimonies, God, that show how alive and how real you are. And God, I pray that you have touched each heart that's in this house today. I pray that each one has sought you with all of their heart. And God, they've heard you and they've answered you, and you have been able to provide for them. Lord, today as we go forth, I pray that you will help us to remember that it's not our accolades, it's not our accomplishments. Those aren't the things that you want. You want a heart that's humble and a heart that's willing to say yes. So God, may each of us make that decision today, if we haven't already, that we will simply say yes to you and carry with you with us each and every step of our days. In your name I pray, amen.